Yeah, thank you, Dr. Ranjit, and the complete entire team of IASR for inviting me on this esteemed platform for delivering my talk. And today's my talk is Digital Autopsies and Hyphenated Techniques, Significance in Solving Crimes in COVID-19 Pandemic. My objective to select this specific topic before it is to illustrate the preparedness of forensic laboratories, hospitals, diagnostic labs, DNA labs in situations like COVID-19. And it needs WHO guidelines, the national safety guidelines to follow. And if we like to ask a question that are we prepared according to COVID-19 pandemic, surely the answer would coming as a no. But I think that somewhere the answer lies in the digital autopsies. So I would highlight the digital autopsies and their relevance in India and the world perspective, and all the problems and the questions which are encountered during this pandemic in the screening of the medical legal cases in toxicology sections, and further the role of forensic toxicologies and the role of hyphenated techniques in solving crimes in toxicology and in chemistry divisions by using the latest techniques and their illustrations of these special cases by GCMS, HPLC, HPTLC, Invisible Spectrophotometry, ADX 8000, ICPS, MS technique, and chromatography. And this will be very beneficial to all the researchers and students who are sitting here. They can do very well about the digital autopsies, their scopes in forensics for new researchers and the students. So when I come across this COVID-19, my objective to select this specific topic is to illustrate the preparedness of forensic labs, hospitals, DNA labs in COVID situations, and it meets WHO guidelines and national safety guidelines. And one question I had asked here that are we prepared according to this COVID pandemic situation? Surely the answer would come is no. And somewhere I think the answer lies in the digital autopsy. So I have selected this topic. And I would highlight the digital autopsies and their relevance in Indian and world perspective and all the problems that encountered in receiving the medical legal cases in the toxicology sections, and then the role of forensic toxicologists and the hyphenated techniques like GCMS, HPLC, HPTLC, Invisible Spectrophotometry, ADX 8000, ICP-MS, and chromatography, lot more techniques. And finally, the scope of digital autopsies in forensics for new researchers and academicians and researchers. So as the onset of COVID-19 in January 2020 in India and the world, there was no preparation to fight with such tragedies that are created by men. And one can term these tragedies as a biological warfare. And the World Health Organization, 18th Jan 2020, declared the outbreak of COVID-19 as a public health emergency of international concern. It affects badly every aspect of human life, from economy, health, behavior, including providing satisfactory analytical output of reports. So being in forensic toxicology, it is our duty to deal with such challenges from examination in laboratory and to provide awareness in day-to-day life. So that's why I've come through with this topic. Here, WHO issues interim guidance on laboratory biosafety guidance related to coronavirus disease COVID-19 on 28th Jan 2021. And these guidelines are based on the understanding about the modes of transmission of COVID-19 sensitivity, its transmission, international autopsy guidelines, and the knowledge about the infrastructure and logistic strength of common mortuaries in India. These WHO guidelines specifically says that it is essential to ensure that health laboratories adhere to appropriate biosafety practices. And any testing for the presence of SARS-CoV-2 equipped laboratories, they may be performed in equipped laboratories by staff trained in the relevant technical and safety procedures, and national guidelines on laboratory biosafety, they should be followed in all circumstances, where the section 4 elaborates about the forensic autopsies in suspected and positive COVID-19 deaths in India. And the section 5 says about the ethical aspects of these autopsies. And they highlights about the SARS-CoV-2 laboratory biosafeties that each laboratory, they should conduct a local, that is institutional risk assessment, and only by personnel with demonstrated capability for each process step, that is from sample collection, preparation, clinical testing, polymerase chain reaction, antigen collection to virus isolation in a validated biological safety cabinets. Even non-propagative diagnostic tests like nucleic acid amplification, sequencing, they should be performed in biosafety level 2. And all propagative work like virus culture, neutralization assays, they should be conducted in biosafety level 3. And a lot more it has been highlighted. So one, before proceeding to the test, should understand the biosafety levels. And looking to this preparedness, it is highly recommended to start by conducting a local risk assessment. And even the section 2, where the medical legal cases are being categorized as confirmed cases of COVID-19, then suspected cases, epidemiological cases, clinical featured cases, and asymptomatic infected cases, where they are, when you diagnose them, you will find the negative results for COVID-19, but they should be treated as suspected COVID-19 deaths cases, as we know that the false negative results are not uncommon. So section 13 also specified about to conclude all these autopsies. But the standard guidelines for the medical legal autopsies in COVID-19 deaths in India specifically says that one should say no to invasive autopsies in COVID pandemic. The doctors, the mortuary technicians, and other mortuary staff in the mortuary performing autopsies, they are exposed to potential high and dangerous health risks to organ fluids and secretions, even after taking the highest precautions. So they say no invasive autopsies technique should be adopted for forensic autopsy. And death due to COVID-19, if it is a non-medical legal case, then the death is in the hospital or under medical supervision, then we should not proceed with the forensic autopsies. But some of the cases of suspected deaths due to COVID-19 virus, which are labeled as medical legal cases, they are sent to mortuaries and police is informed that it may need post-mortem examination for the clarity of cause of death. And here also they specified that forensic autopsies of these cases may be waived off. So one should say no to these invasive autopsies. But what to do with those cases which are homicidal, accidental, and suicidal cases that may be COVID-19 positive or suspected COVID-19 positive? In such cases, an external examination is needed by the autopsy surgeon. He has to look for all possible signs and symptoms that were present over the body, apart from the rigor mortis and postmortem lividity. And he should mandatorily examine every visible injuries, ligature mark, natural orifices, disfiguration, first sign of edema, effusion, ascites. But we all know that these pandemic conditions were, and now is so panic for the patients, doctors, nursing staff, and relatives of the deceased that it was very crucial to follow all the guidelines. And the ground reality is very different than these protocols. So it affects our analysis too. And the reality is that even the genuine patients, they are being examined from far away, and the bodies of COVID patients are being treated as untouchables in many hospitals. And there are many ethical, emotional hurts accompanied with a state of strong fear that nobody questions the system and no satisfactory answer is asked to anyone. There were a lot more news about foul plays with the bodies of COVID patients in terms of organ trafficking market, but no solution is given to us by any of the stakeholders. So what to do in such situation? When we see the deaths, the statistical data of the deaths of the doctors due to COVID-19 in these situations, we have lost many more doctors, and we cannot sacrifice such doctors in for such conditions like COVID-19. So what to do? And even section 13 concluded that autopsies is a legal requirement. It needs to be performed in cases where the law is required. So what to do? Digital autopsies is the solution. Looking to the limitations of avoiding all these invasive postmortems, we are having digital autopsy as the only solution to save our doctors and providing satisfactory answers to the relative of deceased in these pandemic situations. So what is digital autopsy? Digital autopsy is a non-invasive autopsy in which the digital imaging technology, such as the computerized tomography and magnetic resonance imaging scans, are used to develop a three-dimensional images for the virtual exploration of the human body. And if you look into the progress of this technique, one of the first documented digital autopsy studies was conducted at the Department of Neuroradiology in Germany in 1980s, long back. And in 2009, if we see the CTs, it was successfully used by YIFM Australia for disaster victim analysis in case of severe disfigurations. And the, currently, the digital autopsy is being successfully used in many countries like Switzerland, USA, United Kingdom, Malaysia, and Japan. What about the status of India? When I look about the facility of the virtual autopsy in India, it was started in All India Institute of Medical Sciences just in March 2021. This news surprises me a lot, as because this is of the first of its kind in South and Southeast Asia. So we are very far away of these digital autopsies, and it makes me very sad. And looking into the key benefits of these digital autopsies, we should have this technology from very back years. And in this technique, the body remains intact. It takes very less time. Even it is the technique where it is an emerging science, where the doctors attempts to assess the cause of death using the digital CT scan and MRI instead of cutting the body open. And in this technique, the body is placed in a sealed bag and then it put through into a CT scan, and it finishes in seconds and acquires up to 25,000 images of the body's inside. Any internal bearing, bullet pathways, and hidden fractures that are hard to find in the traditional autopsies, they can be detected. However, in AIIMS, we have the digital X-ray machines in the forensic unit in 2016, but that was only for the live patients, and we cannot mix the live patients with the death patients. And when I search for the death cases for all the famous personalities who died in the COVID pandemic in India and the world, I would like to ask once again that do we have the data about their cause of death? If we have already digital autopsy scenario, we can have a lot more information about the suspected deaths. Even we can study them years after this pandemic. It would be very significant for all the medical world and toxicologists in giving satisfactory answer about the cause of deaths. But unfortunately, we are lacking this information because we don't have this facility till March. When I looking into these famous personalities that our first citizen President Pranav Mukherjee, who died due to COVID-19 and heart attack, Rohit Sardana, whose death reason was required with proof, Tarun Gogoi, who died due to COVID-19 complications, Siddharth Shukla, who died due to heart attack, Rishi Kapoor, and many much more cases. In such cases, we need to have a data about through the digital autopsies about the reasons. And in the coming years, it could be very beneficial. I also see the role of digital autopsies in unsolved death cases like that the injuries in the case of the Divya Bharti, where we are still in a state of confusion about accident, suicide or murder. There are a lot more mysteries of Sunanda Pushkar, Sushant Singh, where we need justice for Nidhu Thania and many more, Amina Kumari and Ayushi. These cases can be very well explained on the basis of these digital autopsies. And when we looking into the death mysteries, these can be very useful for studies and the justice purpose, like that of DJ Alalita, Vajaya Bhaduri, and Sri Devi, and Pratushta, and the King of Nepal, whose complete family, the royal family, died in one night. So these murder mysteries can be solved on these basis of these digital autopsies documentations. And when we see the death of Narendra Gui handling that case, it takes a very long time in the post-mortem. And this is not the era where we have to spend a lot more time, specifically in the COVID pandemic. So these invasive post-mortem are very long time consuming destructive techniques. And when we see the conditions of the mortuaries, they are very pity. And these post-mortems takes very long time and most of the information gets lost. It is destructive and based on the individual perceptions. So what we are now left with. So we are left with these autopsies, and the significance of autopsies is that in such situations, the virtual autopsies, it should be our first choice. As because it is ethical, it is not influenced with individual perceptions, it is non-destructive, non-contaminating, no dissection is required. Even it acquires data from difficult regions, from anatomical perspective, and it maintains the dignity of the body, and it can even sympathize the patient's relatives. The digital body is in the system. It can be examined multiple times and reported in form of text, in form of photos, media, etc. In addition, the quick evaluations of bodies and body parts can be done massive disasters cases. Even these features enables the examinations of interested regions and organs from different angles of the body tissues like skin, muscles, and bone. And the histological analysis, where we can utilize the minimally invasive technique, that is an imaging guided biopsy technique, it was implemented for forensic use in corpses. So these techniques make it possible to obtain not only the tissue specimens, but also the sample of urine, bile or blood for the toxicological or DNA investigations. So if I say that need of present hour in the future, this is digital autopsies. In around 20% of adult postmortem examinations and in most podiatric postmortem examination, the cause of death is not immediately obvious. And in a high court ruling in 2015, Mr. Justice McKing stated that an invasive autopsy should be avoided so long as there was a realistic possibility that an invasive autopsy would establish the cause of death. So I would come to forensic toxicology state. And what a forensic toxicologist performs, we know that toxicology is the science of analysis of poison. And histopathological analysis is performed by the pathologist after making slides of histologic tissues from brain, lungs, liver part, and the diagnosis of diseases is done. Similarly, in Ajmer, when I was heading the toxicology laboratory in Ajmer, one of my students and myself have tried to make sections of the tissues of various parts, and their microscopic analysis is done in cases of positive cases of poisoning due aluminum phosphide and insecticide, and we try to see the changes in the structure of the cell organelles and membranes and try to establish the cause of death or the type of the poison. And when I performed this work, I was not aware that in the coming future, I would give a talk on digital autopsies likewise, and there is a much more relevance of this technique in a way like this. In near future, if we have developed this digital autopsies software in a way that by utilizing this histopathological analysis and the type of the poisons, we can have much more information without cutting the body open and taking the most of the body organs out of the body. So this MR microscopy has evolved into a mature technology. This is enhancing the efficacy of basic studies in areas such as phenotyping, pathology, and toxicology. This is my work that I had performed with my student Anjali. Thank you, Anjali, here from site. And we have performed insecticide poisoning, aluminum phosphide poisoning, and we try to see the changes in the sections of the lungs and compare to them with that of the blank samples. And we have found very informative information for this. Now I'm coming to all the medical legal cases which encountered in FSLs. So during pandemic, there is a situation to receive MLC cases at FSLs for examinations of poisons in toxicology lab. Hence, we received them according to our protocol. But when it needs examination, there raises many health concerns and questions by the working scientists. Some have the intentions that wearing PPE kits and performing analysis, it is enough. But in doing so, a proper justification to analysis is not done. Some have the perceptions that already the contents and viscera and the body fluids, they are preserved in saturated solution of common salt. Hence, no virus remains active in this state. Some say if it is of the content in rectified spirit, then it will not affect drastically the human body as well as the environment. Some say that as because most of the tests are performed after extraction process and at high temperature, the virus may not live at these high temperatures conditions. Some perform examinations without performing risk assessment, and some takes a lot of time in getting the guidelines before examination. We know that staff is untrained and under pressure to produce rapid results. And new knowledge about the SARS-CoV-2, including the emergence of new mutations and variants, it may require a risk reassessment. Hence, it is necessary to follow the guidelines of which most of the laboratories are not aware of. And that's why I've explained all these guidelines and one can go through with them. And looking to the aspect of these CT scan in live patients, in the COVID pandemic, a lot more patients, they have been diagnosed, their x-rays has been done. This technique of CT scan is being used. Where in the lungs, in many cases, we have seen the ground glass opacities and they are suggestive of typical pneumonia, likely the COVID-19. So it provides a lot more information in live patients too. And here the role of radiographer is very important and it should be connected to the toxicologist in the near future. And the purpose of forensic radiology is the identification of the bodies, the gender, the body length, individual features like the dental, intracorporeal, all should be documented properly. And all the foreign materials, like in case of gunshots, the bullets, the inserted foreign materials, knives, etc., any other injuries and organ diseases that can determine the cause and manner of the death can be explained by the radiologist and the vitality of the sustained injuries. So what more we require? And finally, the forensic reconstructions, which is as we have performed this reconstruction in the cases of crime scenes, we can utilize them for education and for the research purposes. And when we look into the various radiologic methods, we have to perform the body surface and body volume examinations by macromorphology and micromorphology, and examine the bones and soft tissues and vessels by multi-section CT and MR imaging, and utilization of minimally invasive angiography technique that can be further utilized for the toxicology sections by connecting it to MR microscopy, and the whole 3D color encoded surface scanning and all the data is fused together to provide us much more information. I'm thankful to this paper of Vitopsy that has been published in radiographic volumes and where the University of Bern, Switzerland, and many more departments, Washington's and armed forces, they are connected together. It provides a lot more information where the postmortem sections of 150 around the cases are being examined with that of the Vitopsy, and they try to see its significance. So it gives a lot more information on starting to these information. So we have found that the significance in corpse identifications, where the forensic autopsies would be incapable of demonstrating these findings. If we look into the first picture where we have a helical sort of rare technique of humeral osteosynthesis was found in second picture, the two screws in the left femur. In third picture, the cruciate ligament with the screws in the femur and tibia. In the fourth, the lumbar spine shows percutaneous vertebroplasty with cement. These are the rare techniques of examinations, and due to these techniques, we can identify the corpse also. So this is very important aspect of this digital autopsies, and even the intracranial pressures can be defined as the cause of death. And these postmortem increased intracranial pressure, they have been associated this with the cerebellum, with swelling of these tonsils. And in the lower picture, the traumatic intracranial bleeding is associated with degenerative products of hemoglobin and indicative trauma. So likewise, all the natural cardiac deaths where the findings in the MR image shows local hypointense areas, they can be connected to myocardial hemorrhagic infarctions, and we can give the cause of death that the cause of death is natural. And similarly, the cardiac trauma deaths that stab wounds to the heart, they are being explained on the basis of these CT scan when they compare to the postmortem generally performed. And in the lower picture, the lethal air embolism of the pulmonary artery in the victim of a gunshot wound to the head is connected to the general postmortem autopsies. Look to be very havoc. And coming to the cases like pulmonary edema in the lungs, we can definitely find it then. It is very difficult to cut the whole specimen. So looking to these pulmonary edemas, we can have much more information by these digital autopsies. And in the lower pictures where the lungs are completely 85% covered with that of the water, and only very little part is remained there, and it is suggestive of severe postmortem bronchopneumonia, it can also give its finding here. Drowning cases where the emphysema posum, they can be explained very well on the basis of these CTs, injuries and no injuries, explained on the basis of these findings in the CTs, the hypothermia, the fetal hemorrhages. These all can be explained very well without cutting the body open. And very important, significant aspect is to know the entry-exit gunshot wound. So if we see in this first picture, by this, we can say the direction of the creation of a gunshot wound to the hand, where the arrow suggests that anterior-posterior 3D VRCT image shows an entrance wound, cone-shaped bone defect that enlarges from external to internal. And in the lower picture, the exit wound and the cone-shaped defect that enlarges from internal to external. So what more we needed in such cases, I think it's very significant. And the significance also in this era of COVID-19, where in the crime cases, we have very highly putrefied bodies. And here we can find the cause of death. And one important aspect, likewise in the bodies, we can do the reconstruction of the scene in living and dead, and specific injuries can be explained, as we have seen in this picture, where leg have an injury. And the real data-based 3D forensic reconstructions of incidents explain the injuries of the victim. And this victim was walking with his left knee on the ground when the car hit him. So by this way, we can reconstruct the scenes even very long after the incident took place. Here I would like to highlight the role of Igene company. It was in 2014 when it was contracted by British Transport Police to help the investigation of a suicide. and where these BTP officers need to find the identification of the man who was hit by a train, and they had drawn a blank, but the IG scanned the body and created a 3D digital construction of the man's face. And now the scans were then sent to the experts of forensic anthropology at Dundee University, and then they reconstruct and give a complete identity of this man, and the case is under appeal. So likewise, this IGN has helped out us in much more cases. So if we see the present and future scope of these digital autopsies in India and the world, the main important aspect is in the identification. Identification is very important in forensic aspect, where the identity of the unidentified body in case of disaster, victim and identification in cases of mass casualties such as airplane crash and natural disasters, the human or animal remains of past cultures, they can be investigated about age, gender, injuries and diseases, the cause and manner of the death, if we can highlight about accident, suicide and murder, but we have a different aspect about the cause of death, where some of these causes are specific to certain organs, such as the brain, heart and lungs. So my perception about this autopsy in near future is in toxicology as toxopsy, and in forensic medicine also, where we can analyze the fractures, the pathologic embolism, hyperbaric trauma, gross tissues, injuries. Even the epidemiological basis can assess the morbidity and mortality in the general populations, aiding planning of further research projects. And the applications of microradiology technique is in the evaluation of bone injuries, even the electrical injury pattern on human skin. And MR microscopy, the study of injury pattern in soft tissue, the non-destructive examination of human embryos, and for non-destructive analysis of visceral diseases, as well as effect of toxicants in toxicology. And they can be very well superiorly demonstrated in the courtroom findings settings. Now, one need to follow the step of wearing a PPE kit. However, in this period, we have limited PPE kits for use at crime scenes, and no local risk assessment is specified when we look into the ground conditions. And then handling and processing the specimens like blood and toxicological, serological testing, we should follow the GMPP. And we know that there is a little or no risk assessment is done in this pandemic. So one can use appropriate disinfectants like sodium hypochlorite, ethanol, povidone iodine, chlorxylenol, benzalkonium chloride, chlorhexidine, etc. Looking to the selection of these disinfectant on the basis of their contact time, dilution, self-life and expiry date when the working solution is prepared. So this is all about the digital autopsies, and now I'm coming to simply the hyphenated techniques, their significance. The GSR analysis by EDX 8000, drug quantification by LC-MS, analysis of drugs, pesticides by GC-MS, explosive analysis using FTIR, ICMS, EDX, and analysis of DNA using RT-PCR, ionic component analysis using EDX, metal ion poisons analysis by EDX and ion chromatography, cyanide, ketamine, many more drugs by GC-MS, carboxyhemoglobin, quantifications by UV visibility spectrophotometry and low-mark techniques using HPLC, solving many cases, medical negligence, and so many other cases. So my first case is where I would like to highlight here the inorganic cation and anion analysis in explosive material of Jaipur serial blast, which in long back we have performed by using high-performance ion chromatography using conductivity and UV mode. And here we have specified this inorganic component on the basis of 100% findings by making use of this high performance ion chromatography and the presence of ammonium nitrate, sodium nitrate, potassium chloride, sodium sulfate is being given. And by far the organic compounds are connected. The FTIR characterization of explosive material was performed, where we give the identification of paraffin wax and hydrocarbon oil, and all findings are in 100% accurate. Where the paraffin hydrocarbon and the hydroxyl amine-like substance that indicative of emulsifier that used largely in many explosive formulations manufactured by the licensed companies. So how can we connect it to this? By this, we can trace the manufacturing sites and link it to the terrorist groups. So this work we have devoted to all those soldiers who sacrificed their lives to the nations, and I wish to pay sincere salute to them for their courageous efforts for our nation. By far the crime against women cases are concerned, there are many Nirbhaya cases every day, and the one case is of abduction, drug addiction, rape and murder, which was solved by us. It was a case of poisoning on a young married woman. And here the quantitative determination of chlorpyrifos and phosphine complex in a rape and murder case was performed utilizing these hyphenated techniques, TLC, HPLC, GCMS, and invisible spectrophotometry. This married woman was forcefully abducted outside from his home by four persons using gypsy as a vehicle in the morning, and she was taken to a hotel room. And the girl was drugged and rape was committed, and later on in the evening, she was poisoned using aluminum phosphite and organophosphorus insecticide both. So the articles were sent for examination to us, and we analyzed the poisons in them. And these studies becomes very important to establish the brutality of the offense, that is rape followed by the murder. And one more case is the Anandpal case, which when I was at Ajmer, I solved it by examination of the blood and urine sample of the police person. It was a very cinematic sort of Ferrari, which we seen in the movies, where the tycoons Ferrari from the custody of the police. And it highlights about the big hole in the custody systems and the big plan. And here GCMS analysis of the blood sample urine of the police persons, it clear the use of antipsychotropic drug for the success of Ferrari. Here the GCMS analysis remains very important. And in one of the sweet sample, we have analyzed this drug and established that, yes, of course, the police persons were under the influence of this drug, and utilizing this feature, the Anandpal was absconded. And later on, when this Anandpal died in Fayre's gun battle, here we have highlighted the use of EDS 8000, which is an advanced facility for the detection of shooter that has been created our state of Sil Jaipur. And this technique is based on the detection and classification of gunshot residue particles using energy dispersive X-ray analyzer EDX 8000, and the presence of unique GSR particle on suspect's hand, hair, face, inside nostril and clothing provide conclusive evidence that the person recently discharged a firearm. Now this technique also utilized in identification of bullet holes and discriminating entry and exit hole on the target by the presence and absence of these GSR particles. And similarly, this is being used for qualitative and quantitative determinations of metallic ions in many samples, and also the forensic significance like in the forensic toxicology. This is one more case where a death penalty is given to a rapist after our report, where I was in charge of the crime scene team, and the proper collection of evidences, especially the hair and the blood sample, the single hair was collected, and it can only lead to accurate result to society. So crime scene investigation and DNA analysis by RT-PCR results in giving the death penalty to the rapist on our reports. So by this way, we help out in many cases utilizing this technique, and we are providing training by utility of sexual assault evidence collection kit, and by simulating many crime scenes of indoor and outdoor rape types, and the collection of hair, blood, fibers, skin, nails, semen, bite marks, how to collect them, how to utilize this SIA kit. We are imparting training to the judicial officers, to the visitors, and to the police persons, all the investigating officers, and all the mobile unit forensic persons which are included, and also to the lab personals. And the important thing of the UV visible spectrophotometry is in analyzing the hit and run cases where somebody under the influence of alcohol hit and run, and gives a death of number of persons. So many cases are there, we can utilize UV visible spectrophotometry. We have also analyzed silent killer gas carbon monoxide qualitatively and quantitatively. We have detected carbon monoxide in blood on by use of this UV visible spectrophotometry. Ethyl alcohol, methyl alcohol analysis by GCMS, HS analysis is done in cases of food tragedies and general ethyl alcohol and insecticide poisonings. There are many cases where we take use of GCMS where their murders occur, suicides are there, where in the visceral parts in the blood, we have identified many drugs like ketamine, vicuronium bromide, lorazepam, diazepam, and unknown substances are also being analyzed in cases of train burglary cases. So much more aspect is being provided to us by this hyphenated technique is this COVID pandemic. And this is simple glimpses about the crime scene coverage of the hanging homicide during All India Police Duty Meet, where candidates come to us, where we provide training to them on photography, videography tricks. And many trainings are imparted, and trainings are very important and aspect to strengthen the beginners, the learners, the experts. We are imparting training on use of many kits utilized for the crime scenes, and we give certificates in Forensic Training Research Institute in supervision of our director, Dr. Ajay Sharma, FSL director. So then all these police personnel, they are taking trainings. And one important message which I would like to give on this platform is to join hands, a toxicologist should join hands with that of the researchers, with the students, and with the medical doctors, the crime scene units should join their hands. So one should discuss their problems with each other. The police personnel should incorporate the prosecutors. They should mix with us. The medical jurists should mix with us. And then only finally we can give a complete justification to our cases. And besides, in this platform for the digital autopsy, of forensic toxicologist, medical jurist, they all need to cooperate. And we have a lot more aspect in forensic anthropology and dentology, so many sciences which are emerging these days. And we are having many conferences on this platform of IASR. So this is all about the references which I taking. I hope that it is interesting and significant and make all the listeners to think and work for the bachelor. So thanks for your peaceful listening and giving me this time to share my this vision about the digital autopsies.